there is one heart of the exit strategy that very few people are talking about. That is a very robust disease surveillance program in the country. Not only for COVID-19, but all-cause mortality, all-cause morbidity, at least the large groups of notifiable infections we are worried about. As the monsoons come in, as the summer peaks in, other epidemics will also rise. Because you don't know where the hotspot will be, where the cluster will be. And the lockdown is a very blunt and crude instrument. It shuts down everything because it doesn't know where the problem is. And unless you have a robust disease surveillance backed by testing, you cannot focus post-lockdown effects. You can't even identify hotspots in a issue. That's point number one. And there are many rules to understanding disease surveillance. A lot of people at the top seem to be learning on the job. They should look at what has been learned over 10 years and not try to reinvent it. It's very difficult to build and stabilize an IDSP, Integrated Disease Surveillance Program, and they need to do much better. The second big issue is you cannot look at lockdown as an all or none phenomenon. The aim of it, the sense behind it is to reduce interpersonal contacts. Now, every point, whether it is the household, whether it is the workplace, whether it is access to essential services, whether it is school, whether it is colleges, has a certain level of quantity of interpersonal contacts. So one has to take careful choices how one implements social distancing by rotating at some point the level of contacts that you shut down or decrease. You are just decreasing the probability of contacts. So for example, Sweden, it allows schools to function. In some other place, they will allow certain workplaces to function. They will allow certain public transport to function. They can take turns in different things functioning because overall the amount of interaction that takes place in society should be lowered. This geographical lockdown, where you take a geography and shut down everything, and you can't even step out of your house, not even take a walk along with your wife or your family member, that doesn't make public health sense. The virus doesn't walk through the air. It requires people-to-people contact. So therefore, a scientific strategy will take different areas of social distancing informed by much better understanding of social admixtures. For example, we will know migration. We should have a plan how we will move the migrants back to their homes. They have a right to go home. Who the hell are we as a state to stop people from reuniting with their families? But we can advise them on the safest way to go home and whether we need to do a quarantine or whether it is enough if they do home quarantine and take precautions, or whether we can test them and if they are negative, go home. Depends upon the situation. One need not actually have lockdown, and without advance notice, one should not shut down any place. We're not trying to catch a thief. The disease starts in urban areas, starts within affluent populations, and slowly spreads to rural areas and even poorer populations. So even now, the number of people infected in migrant populations will be low, except where they have been placed in distressing quarantine conditions where they may actually pick it up. But now when they go back, it will spread. So the start of spread in rural areas will be slow. But when it spreads, access to care being lower, access to testing being lower, you may find that actually the disease may fester in some villages, may peak, may cause deaths without knowing. A large part of rural India's deaths occur at home. They occur without any medical attention today, as of today, even before the COVID-19 pandemic. So these deaths may occur and you may not even register them. We've seen that with malaria epidemics. We'll suddenly find a village where there is raging malaria, but the news had not come out and had come out late. The rapid test has two roles. One is in serosurveillance, where its role is definite. But the other, even in a clinical setting, it is valuable if read along with clinical symptoms by a qualified doctor. Tests are not to be interpreted as standalone. you have to interpret it always within a clinical setting. If it is interpreted within a clinical setting, there is nothing wrong with rapid tests per se, and they are reliable. When some of the reports say that virus was positive, but antibody tests were negative, that can be in the early stage of the disease. And in the later stage of the disease, you may have virus negative and the thing. It doesn't mean that there are no infections. It has to be interpreted. On the other hand, if you know through a gold standard, like say an ELISA test or some other test, or you construct a gold standard, and you show that there is a certain titer of antibodies in the patient, but this test is not picking up those antibodies, then you are within fair grounds to say that this test is not reliable. We need to differentiate between a test being reliable within a certain context of when it would expect antibodies in the blood, and another context where actually antibodies, you know, by other means, other tests are in the blood, but you are not able to measure them up. So we should reject kits which have failed the second one. But in the first one, it's a matter of interpretation. There are also issues about training for the kit. There are also issues about the storage temperature and within which the kit should be maintained, and the field conditions under which they are operating. Most of these tests work under 30 degrees centigrade. And if you know, this summer, many places will be above 40 degrees centigrade over there, the ambient temperature. Bottom line, rapid antibody tests are very useful, provided one learns to use them. But this sort of knee-jerk reaction of first ordering tests and then rejecting tests and then saying don't use, you have to go batch by batch. You have to go according to protocols. If you look at countries at our level of health sector performance, our level of GDP and our level of social determinants, you will find that the curve is about the same. If you look at the South Asian countries, if you look at Nigeria, South Africa, you look at many of these countries which are very comparable to us, China to some extent. And at the time of the epidemic, we are in reasonable situation, reasonable comparability of situations. We can't suddenly start comparing ourselves with Spain and the US. Second, we have had a lockdown. The same time, that same gap, Belgium had a lockdown, but it went on to have many more cases. Ours, there's a different social structure. We've had lesser number of cases. But the problem is that what will happen after the lockdown? So in some sense, we are at an early start part of our pandemic. So in terms of the curve, we are so far so good. But we should be very careful, and that we will be seeing a sharp increase. But even now, let me say, I am myself saying that the real numbers may be about 10 times this. And I'm saying so far so good, after I'm assuming that we would be having something like 10,000 deaths and 3 lakh cases, would be, to my mind, within the given context of India's population, a reasonable level of figure that we would have. And even China, I think, would have had much higher figures. Remember, China had only in the Hubei province. They have not yet had in all of China. But in India, it has spread much wider than the few states. So we have at least 5 or 6 states which have a major spread. Except for Kerala, no state has got out of it. Goa also, but Goa never had a major pandemic. I don't know why. That's a very surprising one to me, Goa. But at some point, Kerala has been able to go into endemicity. Kerala will continue to get a small number of cases every week, which is not bad. It should not be seen as a failure. It should be seen as a success. And that level, unfortunately, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh are not reaching, and we may see further spread. So I think we can hopefully be generally doing better, but in some places we have a real problem. It may actually worsen. These mathematicians give us an idea as if we can predict it to the last number of cases. I've even seen an artificial intelligence which gives a date on which the epidemic will end. I don't think that sort of certainty exists, and I am not going to really speculate on this. What one does know is that the epidemic tends to continue till the herd immunity builds up. What we have control over is the rate of spread of the epidemic, not the actual existence. So we're not looking at elimination yet. We are only looking at the rate of spread. So if we slow down the rate of spread, that means we will have it for a longer time, right? So you may find that if it spreads to rural areas and the Hindi heartland, that our peak occurs later in the August to October, November, which is our fever flu season for us. At that time, it may occur. So we may have a much later peak. So we should be prepared for that. And that's one reason we should not exhaust ourselves on lockdowns now, because we may need further strategies down the road. So, this is not a mathematical prediction. I'm saying one scenario that is can develop is this. There are alternative scenarios. But in all scenarios, there is a continuing spread of illness till the vaccine arrives. And in this continuing spread, we do have a control over how the rate of spread and in the area of spread. We won't be able to do much better. We should learn to actually manage within that. We can keep mortality very low, and we can keep economic distress and livelihoods much lower, and we should completely eliminate stigmatization and brutality. That is the first thing that we need to eliminate even before we eliminate COVID-19.